Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Center for Strategic and International Studies. My name is Heather Conley. I'm Senior Vice President here at CSIS for Europe, Eurasia, and the Arctic. And we are absolutely delighted that you could join us for really for the end of a grant or a research period. This is sort of the grand finale. For the last 2 years, CSIS has embarked on a research effort to examine ways to strengthen European Union-U.S. cooperation in the Asia-Pacific region. And I have had the distinct pleasure of having my co-pilot, Ernie Bauer, who is the director of our Southeast Asia program, joining me in this two-year adventure. I'd like to say that we perfectly planned the timing of this conversation to have the second day of the U.S.-ASEAN Special Leaders Summit, but sometimes we just get really lucky, and we got very lucky. This is a very timely conversation. On the second day of this very important summit in Sunnylands, California. So with your permission and very briefly, I'm just going to tell you a little bit about our research that we've done over the last 2 years, and then introduce our keynote speaker, whom we're absolutely delighted could be with us from Brussels. After our speaker concludes his remarks, we'll take a question or so, then we will begin two very interesting panel discussions on strengthening economic cooperation in the Asia-Pacific region and then talking about security issues. So we have a marvelous afternoon ready for you. So the last 2 years, CSIS has pulled together a briefing series on issues of a wide range of interest for both the European Union and the U.S. in the Asia-Pacific region. We've had briefing sessions on energy and climate change. Obviously, trade was a massive component of our conversation. Also, security. Myanmar, building greater democracy, strengthening institutional architecture in the Asia-Pacific region. And we've had a marvelous series of conversations because I think in the first Obama administration term, we had a purposeful initiative to strengthen EU-U.S. cooperation, particularly through ASEAN. And I think in the second term, we lost some of that granularity and dialogue to strengthen EU-U.S. cooperation. In some ways, it was a new commission that was established, a new high representative, a new secretary of state with an enormous array of issues on their plate. And I think we lost a little of that intensity of our dialogue on Asia. And so we were hoping through this research that we could help fill a gap, help strengthen that European-American dialogue on the Asia-Pacific region. I will have to say, through this grant, I have found a couple of things. Many times when European officials would come to visit CSIS, they would want to talk about Asia. I'm certainly not an Asian expert, so I've had a pretty good schooling in issues relating to Asia, and our Asia team here at CSIS has been exceedingly generous in offering their insights in their time and talking to our European colleagues about those trends and issues that are important to Asia. But many times I find Asian experts not willing to sit down with their European counterparts because they don't understand where were the European interests in Asia. So we've had to work very hard on bringing experts together and sharing the importance of this region. Because of the U.S. rebalancing towards Asia, because of the enormous issues, economic and security, that are happening in the region, this dialogue is more important than ever. And again, I'm so delighted that we've carried on this research and that we can present to you some of our early findings of where there's policy convergence in economics and security cooperation in Asia and where there's some divergences. So again, what the common thread, whether we're talking about economics, whether we're talking about security, is the international rule-based order, whether that's in trade and building the highest standards of international trade and investment, or whether that's the standards of international law, freedom of navigation, maritime safety and security. So in some ways, that is the tie that binds this entire conversation about Asia, the international rules that both the EU and the US certainly propose to support. So with that brief introduction to our research, we are delighted to welcome Mr. Gunnar Wiegand, Managing Director for Asia and the Pacific at the European External Action Service, Gunnar, in some ways, is that wonderful nexus between Europe and Asia, because Gunnar, in a previous life, served as the Deputy Managing Director of Europe and Central Asia, and was the Director of Russia, Eastern Partnership, and Central Asia, and the OSCE at the External Action Service since 2011. And that's where I got to know Gunnar in his work as being a critical negotiator for the EU-Ukraine Association Agenda, as well as the EU coordinator for the EU-Russia Partnership. He has been a longstanding colleague in the European Commission, working on external relations and trade policy. So we have a transatlanticist who's also now focusing on the Asia-Pacific region. Gunnar, we're looking forward to your comments and your reflections from the External Action Service. And I can tell you, many of us are looking forward to the forthcoming European Security Strategy, which we hope certainly has an important articulation of the European Union's interest in the Asia region. So with that, let me thank you again for being here with us, welcome you, and please join me in welcoming Gunnar Wiegand to provide our keynote address.
Well, dear ladies and gentlemen, thank you for giving me this opportunity to address you at the CSIS. I'm back in Washington. I have been twice in my career in charge in different functions of EU-US relations. I studied also in the city, but it's, I think, 31 years ago that I got my master's degree. The world has changed a lot since then. And there are many Asia experts here sitting in the room. I'm not one of them. I'm in the same situation as Heather. I did deal with Asia in as much as Central Asia is linked to important partners of what is defined of being Asia in the US definition. But I would like to come to this definition at this stage also because there is a certain tendency of talking about Asia and meaning East Asia. Asia in the European perspective, and you will appreciate that Europe shares the same continent with many of our Asian partners. Asia starts in our definition with Afghanistan and Pakistan and India, and then it goes on. And we share, of course, the same continent also with China. And therefore, we are in many ways neighbors and have many connections on that continent. And these are long-standing and these are historic connections. I want to stress from the beginning, talking here in Washington about the subject, that we see, despite these long-standing historic and very strong economic links with many partners in Asia, that we have here also a key area of close and strategic transatlantic cooperation. Thanks to this event here, the first longer mission I do in my new job is going here to DC and going, in fact, this evening to New York, to the UN. There are so many important matters in Asia which are being discussed here, and the high stakes couldn't be more underlined by the Sunnyland Summit, which takes place between ASEAN leaders and the US President. Cooperation with Asia matters a lot in this country and is on the top of the news. In Europe, that's not always the case. That's on the top of the news. It is strategic, it is important, it is being done, but we have so many issues in our southern and eastern neighborhood, that's the area where I have had responsibility over the last couple of years, that these are very often crowding out the very important strategic challenges and opportunities we have in the Asia-Pacific space. both of us on both sides of the Atlantic, we have huge stakes in the future of Asia, and of course the U.S. does it also as a Pacific power. The center of gravity in political, economic, and security terms on the globe moves towards Asian powers, and there's a fast-changing global landscape. We have different profiles and footprints in Asia. The EU's footprint is a long one, a centuries-long history binds us with Asia, and in fact, it's the biggest two trade partners of Asia and the largest aid budgets, which link Europe with Asia, plus strong research and tourism links. While the U.S. as a Pacific power is also a security guarantor, has forged specific alliances with different Asian partners, and has a huge Asian population inside the United States. So there are differences. We shouldn't deny them, but we are both linked in a variety and in strong ways to Asia. We are even strong economic competitors, I would say, U.S. and EU companies in Asia. However, that's also to be differentiated because many of the U.S. companies are, in fact, European companies incorporated in the U.S. who operate in Asia. And there are also U.S. companies incorporated in Europe which act in Asia. And that is a reflection of the very strong investment link we have between the U.S. and Europe. What is key to underline, despite all these differences, is that we share very similar interests in the overall security and stability of Asia, in securing open markets, in making sure that rules are observed, that rule of law is applied, and Heather did refer to that commonality already, in the respect for freedom of choice for countries, individual countries, freedom of choice, but also for individuals, freedom of choice, to shape their own future, both domestically and internationally. We want a regional order based on international law and agreed rules, based on strong institutions and functioning networks. We do not believe in spheres of influence, and we do not believe in historic rights, which give usually rise to conflictual situations. Given that similarity in strategic outlook, it makes a lot of sense to seek to strengthen transatlantic cooperation in and not on, but in any case with Asian partners. Whether this is on Afghanistan or on Myanmar, whether this is on ASEAN, on maritime issues, on cyber issues, we can pull in the same direction. We can draw on respective strengths and profiles, but without giving arguments to those who see in all of this a kind of the West is ganging up. We need to take into account sensitivities, legitimate sensitivities, and historic sensitivities. We absolutely must be able to discuss strategic issues in the Asian space between us, including tough ones, such as those linked to China's assertiveness towards its neighbors and maritime security issues, and these are very prominent exactly today with the news from certain islands. We need to be able to talk about issues linked to new banks being created or to overcapacities in certain industries, but without antagonizing anybody and without creating an alliance which would not allow us to value the strength of arguments in our respective dialogues with partners in the region. Such strategic dialogue between the EU and the US will not mean that we would agree on everything. In fact, rarely ever in transatlantic dialogues we agree on everything. But we would know better what the other side is thinking, planning, doing. That helps. And I know that many in the city think Europe doesn't have any Asia policy. Europe has no interest in Asia. Europe is no power in Asia. Well, those may not have had much dialogue with Europeans about it. Transatlantic dialogue and cooperation in Asia has grown in recent years, but it has fluctuated, depending on personalities, depending also on the urgent priorities. Compared to other parts of the world, transatlantic dialogue on Asia is less structured, less anchored. Despite a very significant and very detailed joint statement between Secretary of State Clinton and then High Representative Vice President Ashton of 2012, which foresaw precisely that. Let me try to sketch how Europe sees the main trends in Asia, their implications, and what in terms of policy we are doing. The starting point is clear: economic, security, demographic trends all lead towards growing importance of the wider Asia-Pacific in the global system. The reasons why you pivoted to Asia or conducted the rebalancing also apply to Europe. It's not that Europe is standing there and say, "My God, where has the US gone? We are now alone with the Asians." We have the same reasons as you have. In fact, Europe never left Asia. We didn't have to discover it. What has happened in the work between the EU and the US is that the urgent, meaning the crisis-ridden neighborhood around Europe, has sometimes edged out the important, the also important. And that is to enhance our engagement in and with Asia in strategic ways. Let's be clear, even with the Chinese economic slowdown about which so many economists write these days, 60% of global growth in 2015 came from Asia. A huge rising middle class offers not just economic opportunities, but also the prospect of greater convergence of political and social goals and aspirations. European middle class societies, American middle class society, there will be more and more Asian middle class societies. Some Asian partners already there. So we see Europe as being part of building that new Asia and working with that newly self-confident number of Asian partners. In security terms, Asia matters too. There are maritime disputes in East and the South China Sea, on the Korean Peninsula in dramatic ways. This has been underlined in the last couple of days again. In Afghanistan, all these directly affect also EU interests. These are regional issues, but with global ramifications. As my new boss, High Representative Vice President Mogherini, says, insecurity, as much as security, is global in nature. So Asia's role in tackling global challenges like illegal migration, like piracy, cyber threats, will significantly and directly affect the capacity to find effective global responses. We need Asian partners to fight global threats and to find global solutions. More generally, Europe and Asia have strong mutual interests in addressing challenges which emanate from what some people call the zones of chaos between Asia and Europe. I will not mention them by name, but many know which countries or zones we mean, and which are geographically exactly between those growth centers and prosperity spaces. Migration pressures, illegal, sudden, radicalization, terrorism, state failures, ungoverned spaces, all this exists between us. And what impacts Europe also impacts Asia, and increasingly so as recent terrorist acts in Indonesia underlined, just as an example. In all of this, Economics and security are interlinked. Asia's growth rests on continued regional stability. Nobody can have interest in regional instability. That's why the Asian paradox matters to non-Asians too. The economic paradox being that economic Asia is built on integration and on optimism, while the security Asia is faced with fragmentation and pessimism. We all know that existing regional security architecture is not yet robust enough to manage rising tensions and geopolitical competition, and that people are hedging. A word I heard a lot here in Washington these days. ASEAN is at the heart of the emerging regional cooperation frameworks and the best for a rules-based regional order. And you will not be surprised that coming from a regional integration scheme called European Union, we are very much in favor of rules-based regional orders. The United States is engaging much more with ASEAN, talking now about a strategic partnership with ASEAN, underlined so much by the summit yesterday and today in California. The EU is also scaling up its engagement with ASEAN, forging a more ambitious and political partnership, including areas of security cooperation, but including also economic integration and many areas of sectoral cooperation. Now, this interlinkage means also interlinkage in the other way. Europe matters to Asia. The more familiar or the most familiar face of Europe is the huge trade and investment footprint. In fact, having worked many years on transatlantic relations, I was surprised to learn that the EUDAP does more trade with Asia than across the Atlantic. In 2014, the EU-Asia trade was 1.3 trillion euros, while the trade between the EU and US was 517 billion euros. And even if the transatlantic investment is still much bigger than either US or EU investment in Asia, this too is changing, and actually the EU has been for years the biggest investor in ASEAN, with not less than 25% of the total investment. As you have just closed negotiations on the Trans-Pacific Partnership, the EU has equally ambitious trade strategy with Asia. FTAs have been negotiated with Korea in application, with Singapore, with Vietnam, and we are negotiating with Japan, India, Thailand, Malaysia, and the Philippines to start soon. The ultimate goal is an EU-ASEAN region-to-region FTA. The EU is also a huge development partner, so it's not only about security and economics, it's also about assistance. For all the excitement of Asian miracles, the Asian continent still contains the largest number of people living in poverty. The EU engagement in Asia, therefore, comprises not only trade and aid, but is also linked to security in a comprehensive way. The work in Asia can be described as was done last year at the Shangri-La meeting in Singapore by Mrs. Mogherini. The EU perhaps is not an Asian power, but is definitely an Asian partner, pursuing cooperative security rather than binary strategic choices. I would like to quote an early engagement in Aceh after the tsunami. The current engagement in the Mindanao peace process in the Philippines or in Myanmar regarding ethnic peace and police reform. All these are examples of ongoing engagement of the EU in Asia, which may be largely unknown in the city. More specific, the priorities for this year. First, the EU will work out a new EU strategy on China. As a global actor, the EU is reinforcing its relations with China, a China which is increasingly active in all corners of the world, including as an investor in Europe and as a foreign policy player in a growing number of regions, including on issues that are crucial for Europe's security, such as Iran and Syria. China is not anymore a distant partner. China forms increasingly a direct part of our citizens' lives. So we wish to forge a modern, principled, and above all, a united approach with all of our member states. How to engage with China, not just in a huge and expanding bilateral relationship, but also as a global player. We intend to have a common script to tackle the big economic issues, and this includes the domestic reform agenda, and I would like to just make a passing reference to market economy status and to state-owned enterprises with significant overcapacities. But we also need to tackle with China big global issues such as climate change, migration, and regional issues. We will put all these different elements together, and the one key element which will bind them together is to work together on new challenges, but to work together on the basis of international rules. That rules-based cooperation is key to have predictability. And that is again where US and EU dialogue is important. The other big priority for us in 2016 is staying the course on Afghanistan, to have a situation where the country stabilizes, does not slip back into the hands of radical elements, and provides perspectives for all of its citizens. This is partially also in response to the significant influx of illegal migration from Afghanistan. This is the second largest inflow in Europe. Last year we had the first largest group with migrants coming from Syria, and the second largest group with almost 250,000 from Afghanistan. We need to make sure that there is not a new black hole opening with massive instability and export of instability, but that there is perspective for people to return to their countries, to their country. And it's key that we stand together with the US on this, and we will see a big ministerial conference in Brussels on 4th and 5th of October, where the international community will have to pledge new support, but in a clear political framework to stabilize Afghanistan's development, including new donors from Asia, not only the traditional donors. China has a stake in Afghanistan, as it shows by its participation in the 2+2 negotiations alongside the US, Pakistan, Afghanistan. The third priority is to ensure success of democracy where democracy finally arrives, and we have such a case in Myanmar where beginning of April we will have a new democratic government respecting the will of the people. We have been a key partner during the historical transition of this country, which has moved with great speed, and most people thought this would never be possible from a military rule to a democratic rule. We must make sure that from opposing military rule, there comes now democratic governance, which is effective and responds to the expectations of the population. It is good to see that we have also such positive examples. And in Sri Lanka, there is another one where a country has overcome civil war, and where democratic norms are being applied again and for the entirety of the population. These are places also where Europe, together with Asian partners, Europe together with the U.S. can make a difference and ensure that democracy and reconciliation can take place. I did already refer to ASEAN, and you all looked at the pictures from Sunnyland. Well, ASEAN has launched a new phase in its existence. You may all appreciate that we have been partners of ASEAN since its very beginning. Now ASEAN has also an economic community since the beginning of January, and that is integration, boosting prosperity, and also tackling regional challenges. We have put a detailed offer on the table in improving our relations with ASEAN. We are not boasting EU integration as a model. We are partners in integration. ASEAN plays a central role in building a more robust regional architecture, and that includes security-related work by their defense ministers and also at summit level at the East Asia Summit. The EU is ready to do more in that respect and to be part of that. We do not pursue a geopolitical agenda. These times are over. We do believe there's a lot of hard power politics in place in the region. But the EU is well placed to support cooperative structures, whether they exist in economic terms, in political terms, or in security terms. And therefore, we work with partners in ASEAN on maritime security, border management, disaster relief, mediation, crisis management. I would like to underline in this context the area of maritime security, freedom of navigation, of arteries of global economies are essential for Asian partners as much as for American partners. We need to ensure that one of the outcomes of globalization, meaning integrated supply chains, can function with such arteries not being under threat. But we need to do this in full respect of international law. Regional security requires that confidence is built, and confidence is built on norms which are common to all. Agreed rules make states secure, people free, and companies willing to invest. And talking about maritime disputes, which have become very prominent, the EU position is crystal clear. We are committed to maintain maritime order based on international law, and that includes the Convention on the Law of the Sea. We do not have a position on specific claims, but we have a principled and a clear position on how they should be resolved. We certainly strongly support the revitalization of the ASEAN-China negotiations for a code of conduct for the South China Sea and hope they can be concluded soon. We cannot see that any unilateral solution or any militarization would help to advance the situation. We are concerned by any unilateral actions which increase tensions. And we strongly oppose any attempt to territorial claims through intimidation, coercion, or force. We therefore call on all states to pursue peaceful and cooperative solutions, and that includes internationally recognized dispute settlement mechanisms, such as arbitration. Finally, a word on connectivity. That seems to be the word which is most used between us, in particular between Europe and Asia, because we want to have more connections. It's a buzzword, rightly so, across the region. China, ASEAN, India, all are developing ambitious plans. The Asian New Infrastructure Investment Bank, the One Belt, One Road initiative of China, but also our new EU-China connectivity platform, they all serve that purpose. It presents huge opportunities to connect better markets, to connect better people between Europe and Asia, shaping the Eurasian continent. But it's also clear that we need to work on this in a more strategic way, in a way which is more based on common approaches and rules, and certainly more transatlantic coordination on this one is also much welcome. Because it is not just about economic or infrastructural development. It is also linked to strategic moves, interconnections between different spaces. The rules of engagement should be internationally agreed and can't certainly be unilaterally imposed. We need to break silos and bring together those who work on infrastructural tasks as engineers, those who work on these tasks as financiers, those who work on this as economists, and those who think about foreign security policy implications. And in fact, one of the places where we will do this will not be at the EU-China summit only later this year, but also at the Asia-Europe meeting, where we combine 53 heads of state and government of Asia and Europe in Mongolia mid-July. It also requires that we are capable of working on the dark side of connectivity, as the Thai Permanent Secretary recently put it to me. In ASEAN, we think a lot about the dark side of connectivity. I didn't know this concept, but it is some of the security-related challenges, of course, which go with that global connectivity. On the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, the US decided not to join. Well, many of our member states decided to join and did engage in order to shape this bank together with the Asian shareholders to ensure standards of the bank in line with bank best international practice. It seems that this strategy pays off to work together on building something new. And the same we need to do on the One Belt, One Road approach. As a conclusion, allow me to share with you that we are deeply convinced that the Asia-Pacific region is of strategic importance, of growing importance, and that this is not just from an EU or US perspective, but this is also in view of the global prosperity and security impact. And if you talk to Africans, if you talk to Latin Americans, they would see it the same way. That means we need to step up engagement and not think in isolating or containment terms. And we must make best use of respective strengths and assets. Between the EU and US, it means also that we need to coordinate better and more systematically, acknowledging that sometimes we are competitors in the economic field, but we do share common, broader political interests, and certainly we do share basic values, and we do share the need to preserve the rule of the law, the international norms. This applies to our cooperation across the world, but in the Asia-Pacific region in particular. And I thank you therefore very much for having organized, and there will now be panels looking at the specific elements. Thank you very much.
Gunnar, thank you very much for that comprehensive overview. We do have time for one question or two, if you'd like, for Mr. Wiegand, and then he's got to run to the airport. But do we have any questions? Here's your opportunity. All right, I'm going to take the opportunity. Gunnar, you mentioned market economy status and the EU decision. That decision has been postponed. I wonder if you could just illuminate us on what the process is that the EU must undertake to make a determination about China's market economy status.
The decision on this question is obviously a very complex one and will have to be taken on the basis of the best available facts. the best available facts are currently being established, first on the basis of a thorough impact assessment, which the Commission is undertaking, Commission economists are undertaking, going through various scenarios. And what does it mean? It's the impact of providing the market economy status to China and what it would mean in terms of the additional export opportunities in particular sectors. In particular sectors of those industries where China has not undertaken market economy reforms and where there exist huge overcapacities. That's one area of fact-finding, and the other one is to do a stakeholder consultation process, which is ongoing, which has just been opened by the Commissioner for Trade last week. So this will take some time, and then on the basis of these facts, there will be further discussion in the Commission. And I cannot prejudge what these discussions will bring, but if ever the Commission would decide to take a legislative initiative, I just would like to underline that this is a process which takes time because it has to go through the Council of Ministers and the European Parliament. But we are not there, so now we are in the fact-finding phase. I think the gentleman there had one question.
Absolutely, sir. If you'd like to take a question, the microphone is coming towards you. If you could please identify yourself and your affiliation. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Philip Benarczyk, House Foreign Affairs Committee. You mentioned the space in between Europe and Asia, and so I'd ask you a question maybe that you're a little more familiar with, the relationship between Russia as a player, both economically, strategically, for the U.S. and Europe when it comes to Asia.
Well, Russia is, of course, as they would say to us, first and foremost, also an Asian power. Because they have also significant territories in Asia. They are a Pacific power, and interestingly enough, they participate also in the Asia-Europe meeting on the Asian side. Taking into account that that Russia has about 80% of its population and about 80% of its GDP in the European part of Russia, it shows that Russia is, in fact, the embodiment of how close Europe and Asia are on the same continent. And Russia is, of course, a neighbor and a very important partner, and a partner linked with the EU in a way that we can talk about economic interdependence. I don't believe that Russia has a similar degree of economic closeness with Asian neighbors, whether they are called China or Japan. But of course, they are very important partners as well. And then there are a number of structures which Russia belongs to, like the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, where there's a privileged close cooperation between Russia and China. Some people have speculated over the significant difficulties which we are experiencing in our relationship between the EU and Russia over the question of Ukraine, that Russia now would turn away from Europe and go with China. I can only say this is a simplistic view. You cannot just change it's very strong economic relationship, not to speak about the many other forms of that relationship, with another one. But it's clear that it is the intention to have a very much closer connection for the energy exports from Russia to China, and to have a closer strategic cooperation as well. We see this is probably slower than many people would have thought in Russia. It is, however, something which is a natural development. It is not moving away. It is diversifying relations, as everybody does. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Please join me in thanking Gunnar Wiegand for wonderful keynote remarks. And now Now I'd like to welcome our economics panel forward, please. Don't leave your seats. We're about to begin. Thank you.
Well, welcome back. I'm Ernie Bauer. I'm the chair for Southeast Asian Studies here at CSIS. I'd like to thank my colleague Heather Conley for her leadership and partnership in this two-year endeavor. We really enjoyed working with our European colleagues. As a guy who tracks Asia and Southeast Asia generally, Southeast Asia specifically, it's been refreshing to hear about our European colleagues' perspectives. I think Europe brings a certain dose of pragmatism to the table, and they have taught me one thing that I think fits quite naturally with the way Asians see diplomacy, and it's something that I think the White House and the Americans are learning also and embracing, and that is that economics is the foundation for an enduring security in Asia. Security won't work in the long run without a strong economic foundation. And I think Europe has is in the process of proving that. It's a dynamic process. I thought I heard Gunnar in his keynote address talk about some of the things that Europe is prioritizing in that sense. And I think it's appropriate, therefore, that our first panel in today's session will look at the economics. We've entitled the panel TPP and Beyond, an understanding of future trade dynamics and investment architecture in the Asia-Pacific region. And we've got a great panel to talk to you about those issues. And then that'll leave time for engagement of the audience. On my far right is our guest, Moreno Bertoldi. He's the Minister Counselor and Special Advisor to the Ambassador at the Delegation for the European Union to the United States. He's spent a lot of his career looking at the G20, IMF, global economic architecture, the G20 framework for growth. He's also been posted here in the United States before, as well as in Japan, and has a broad understanding of these issues, broad and deep, I should say. On my right, Scott Miller, my colleague, is the Scholl Chair for International Business. There's no one better who should be holding that chair. Scott Miller is, for those of us who know him well, an encyclopedic mind on business's perspective of economics. He worked for years with the Procter & Gamble Company, and when it comes to trade economics, business issues related to U.S. policy, I think all of us try to stop by Scott's office and get updates and insights. Our favorite hobby now is to find out what he thinks about TPP and whether it will pass, so you're going to all be privileged to get an update on that. And on my left, an old friend, Drew Quinn. He is a tough guy, literally a tough guy, and you have to be to do the job that he does. He's the Deputy Assistant U.S. Trade Representative for Southeast Asia and the Pacific, and most importantly, and I'm sure he's logged many, many hours on this part of his job description, he's the Deputy Chief Negotiator of the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or the TPP. Congratulations on getting that one across the line, Drew. But Drew's been one line. You got an agreement. But Drew has been in these mines for years, working on trade agreements the United States has done with Asian countries. He came to the USTR from the White House Drew's been posted in Seoul, Korea, Islamabad, in Pakistan, Tokyo, Bangkok, and he also did a tour in Kabul in the U.S. Embassy in Afghanistan recently. I think that was 2009, 2010. Just in case, you know, his toughness was questioned. He was working there on narcotics and law enforcement assistance. So, you know, it's one of those key things you need before you're a complete trade negotiator. So, really look forward to hearing from this panel. It's going to be should be an interesting group. And Drew, since I introduced you last, I'm going to start with you and give you the floor.
Thanks, Ernie. And I should clarify, when I was in Kabul, I was actually working on counter-narcotics, not narcotics. So I was asked just to provide a few remarks on TPP and beyond and what it says for sort of U.S. objectives in the trade and investment architecture of East Asia. And I think, you know, when for the purposes of this discussion, when we think of Asia, we're thinking principally of East Asia, where the dynamism is, where patterns of global commerce are being transformed. I would also, you know, much of my remarks will be linked to the TPP agreement, not simply because it's you know, being actively discussed and debated now, but also because I think when we're looking actually at sort of strategic goals or architecture, it's the purest distillation of what we're seeking to do, as opposed to the bilateral issues that come up in all of our bilateral relationships and that we seek to manage. You know, I think when we look at our objectives for the region, U.S. objectives, you know, they're largely similar to Europe's, frankly. I mean, we want to see greater transparency. We want to see greater openness in commerce. We want to see greater fairness. We definitely are committed to a strong rules-based system, adherence to commitments that have been made in multilateral, plurilateral, and bilateral frameworks, the establishment of strong norms-based institutions. I would say one thing that has surfaced with particular sort of salience in East Asia in recent years has been the rise of so-called state capitalism and what the implications that have for fair competition and ensuring that it doesn't impede fair competition or market access. So I think that's one of the things that has animated a lot of our thinking is how to respond to this, how to make sure that it doesn't diminish our ability to engage with these economies. You know, I think this builds on a lot of the commitments that we had previously in agreements with Singapore, with Australia, with Korea, our past trade agreements. But I think clearly with TPP, we took that one step further. You know, if you look at the main sort of principles behind TPP, number one is comprehensive market access. You know, this obviously every country has sensitivities, including the United States, but the goal is to have an agreement that reaches across all segments of the economy and provides market access and eliminates those barriers. But maybe something that has become as strong an objective and priority for us is the establishment of a high standard framework for trade and investment. And, you know, I think sometimes we haven't done as good a job as we could have in explaining what we mean by high standard. But I think the notion here is that we need to make sure that expansion of trade and economic opportunity goes hand in hand with greater transparency, with protection of labor rights, with protection of environment, with expanding or promoting promoting innovation. And so all of these kind of, you know, all of these objectives, the kind of issues that are addressed in the 30 chapters of the agreement, are, we believe, and, you know, working with our 11 TPP partners, sort of strike the appropriate balance in terms of the kind of framework you're trying to create to promote a system of broad-based growth where we all benefit from increased commerce. The other thing that we absolutely set out to do in TPP, and we think successfully, was to address these new issues that have not been addressed in past trade agreements, because commerce changes a lot faster than the thinking of trade negotiators, and, you know, we need to make sure that we're not using a 20th century template to try to address 21st century commerce. And so, again, one of the key elements of that in TPP is the chapter on state-owned enterprises that addresses the, not you know, it doesn't put a bullseye on state ownership. What it does, though, is it says if you're going to have state ownership of commercial enterprises, they need to compete by the same sort of rules that govern commercial enterprises. Another area where we go further in TPP than ever before is the rules that we've created to make sure that barriers don't get erected to digital commerce, because digital commerce nowadays is as important in many respects as actual physical commerce, not simply to digital businesses, but even to manufacturers. And I think you saw that most recently, maybe at one example when GE announced that it was moving to Boston so that it could more actively plug into digital developments, even for its industrial businesses. I would say another element that we looked at in TPP was to go beyond what we had done in past agreements to try to broaden the benefits of the agreement, very consciously trying to set up frameworks to identify potential obstacles and eliminate those to small business participation in FTAs, to look at development and actually create a framework to ensure that this agreement of multiple parties from varying levels of development could actually be used to promote broad-based economic growth and channel to promote development objectives, something we had never done before in our past agreements. Looking at supply chain issues and actually creating a framework to look at supply chains to make sure that the discrete elements of the agreement are actually coming together to have the impact on regional trade that is one of the paramount objectives of this agreement. So again, I think all of those sort of elements of TPP speak to you know, what we believe should be the appropriate architecture for the region in terms of trade and investment. And, you know, we had the good fortune to have a lot of like-minded partners in TPP. The negotiations took a while, but they were productive. And one of the benefits of them taking a little longer than some people anticipated was that we were able to actually expand the membership in the course of the negotiations, thus expanding the potential economic impact of TPP, but also I think its role in the region. I think when we began TPP, a lot of people thought, well, you know, you're too ambitious to ever achieve these goals, but also this is the U.S. and a number of smaller economies. And I think by the time we completed the negotiations with 12 economies, including the first and third largest economies in the world, I think everyone realized that, you know, representing 40% of global GDP, what we were doing at TPP was actually going to have a significant impact. So looking beyond TPP, and you know, where do we go from here? Obviously, we look forward to a robust public debate on TPP, and that's appropriate. And this is an agreement that really warrants it because it is that important an agreement. And I think there's maybe a lot of misunderstandings that we you know are on us to clarify and explain. And I think we're getting around trying to explain that and you know, have active discussions. But I think, you know, in terms of the region and our economic engagement with the region, you know, I think from our perspective, one of the really, you know, gratifying, if maybe unanticipated developments of the completion of TPP negotiations was how quickly it has sort of informed and to some extent shifted a lot of the debate on trade and investment in the region. I think a number of countries in the region maybe were wishing TPP would just go away, and not just the participants. But I mean, a lot of countries were observing it, wondering, okay, you know, we would, you know, just as soon not have to sign up to this kind of stuff. Maybe they won't succeed. But when we did, I think they realized that they needed to start, you know, beginning to consider if they'd undertake these same kind of reforms in order to keep pace with what countries in the region, not just the U.S. and Japan and Singapore, but also the Vietnams, the Malaysias, the Perus, the Brunei emerging economies were undertaking. I think a lot of people sort of were struck when Indonesia's president came to Washington soon after the completion of negotiation and identified, you know, joining TPP as a goal for Indonesia, because I think there was you know, nothing that had led people to expect that kind of pivot in Indonesia's identified trade objectives. And it's not just, of course, with Indonesia, but with other countries as well. The other aspect of TPP is, of course, that it will be, you know, a regional agreement that other countries can seek to join. And I think, you know, that has already, again, manifested itself in a number of countries stepping forward now, having wondered if they really wanted to begin this process. Now that the agreement is done, now that they can see that their competitors, their rivals, have have signed up to these kind of disciplines, not only because it provides market access, although realistically that's an important part of it, but also because they actually believe that this is an important part in their own domestic reform, and I think that's helping them make the case within their own sort of domestic councils about why this would serve their needs. And, you know, clearly the Koreans, with whom we already have a free trade agreement, have been, you know, some of the most public in talking about the possibility of seeking to join TPP in the future when we get it approved, the Philippines as well. And I guess, you know, I would also just say that, you know, even for countries for whom a membership in TPP is not a, you know, something that you would consider a reasonable near-term prospect, I think you can see that the kind of principles, the kind of obligations, even if done on a voluntary basis, are informing a lot of our work with the other countries in Asia. We're having a meeting of the U.S. ASEAN TIFA today. Out in the West Coast, obviously following on the historic meeting in Sunnylands. And I think, you know, as we think about ways that we can deepen our trade relationship with those ASEAN members that are not in TPP, for example, one of the things we're trying to do is talk about how we can build capacity and build comfort so that they can strive toward maybe towards a long-term goal of being able to participate either in TPP or in TPP-like agreements. And again, that's both on an ASEAN-wide basis, but then also with the individual ASEAN members. So I think those, you know, I think what we have accomplished in TPP, you know, was a pretty heavy lift over the last few years. But I think you can look at this as reflecting a lengthy series of consultations with Congress, with our stakeholders in the business community, in the labor community, in the NGO community. About how we can pull together a trade policy towards East Asia that reflects both our interests and our values, and I think we will be seeking to build on that and draw on that in the years to come.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Drew. That was great. Scott, let's turn to you. What's the outlook here?
Okay, thank you, and it's a pleasure to be here this afternoon. And let me start by congratulating Drew and the entire U.S. government team who worked for basically 5 years solid on delivering an excellent Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement. It really is a breakthrough in a lot of ways. We owe them a great debt of gratitude for what they were able to do. You can look at this, when you look at the depth and comprehensiveness of TPP and then consider the diversity of its partners. It's really quite an accomplishment. Most pleasingly, it does have substantial appeal beyond the existing parties. Drew mentioned this is open architecture, as we trade wonks would say, but there's already a list of economies who have expressed interest in becoming members of TPP, at least beginning the process. And I think that's a credit to the quality and importance of the agreement, so congratulations. With that, I'm going to get a little negative. And it has to do with what's going on in the region. That we had a long period of time in the Asia Pacific where economic integration was both good policy and good politics, and somehow we've lost that narrative. Now, let me describe this. I think for the last 25 years, one of the safest predictions in international policy was that Asian economies would more deeply integrate, however you want to define that. If you look at the track record of regional trading arrangements, consider Asia broadly, the 48 members of the Asian Development Bank. That's basically Afghanistan to Vanuatu and everything in between. All right. Among those 48 members in 1991, there were seven regional trading arrangements. In 2007, just before the Great Recession, there were 155 RTAs in place, entered into force, and another 42 either proposed or under negotiation. In that 42 would be RCEP and TPP. So these were big deals that were still under consideration. Since the recession, it's really fallen flat. And you can start this loss of the narrative that this is actually a good thing to do. This deeper integration is a good agenda to have. You can begin to see it in the trade data. My colleagues and I looked broadly at sort of what happened to why we wound up with such a great trade slowdown. Because from the mid-1980s to 2007, because of good policy and because of technology, trade grew annually about twice as fast as output. So every year, if you had 3.5%, 4% GDP growth. You had 8 or 9% trade growth for basically a generation. It was amazingly good for global prosperity. Now, of course, trade collapsed in 2009, bounced back a little, mostly in 2010, but really since 2011, global trade growth has only been about as fast as global GDP growth. So we lost that margin of acceleration. And in fact, in some key economies, there are outright declines. This morning's Wall Street Journal reported that Singapore, the canary in the coal mine, reported January exports down 10% versus year ago. It's only a month, but it's down 10%. Same period of time, South Korea exports, January versus year ago, down 18%. Okay, this is a problem, right? Now look, there's lots of reasons. The growth recession in China, slowdown in China has something to do with this. Certainly commodities, the end of this commodity super cycle has a lot to do with it because you're moving lower volumes of commodities and those commodities are moving at lower prices. And that has a compound effect. So I understand the math there. What worries me most is the lack of policy improvement, all right, because policy improvement was a hallmark during that 25 years of sort of virtuous growth. And while there hasn't been a lot of new policy, TPP being a breakthrough in that light and a very welcome addition, there have actually been some outright reversals. We have some big economies in Asia, India and Indonesia to name two, which have reversed course, which have moved away from liberalization, which have abandoned or abrogated their investment agreements, which are practicing, if it's not import substitution, it certainly rhymes with import substitution. It's it doesn't look good for the region as far as deeper integration. That's kind of a problem. So with that, today's conference is a US-EU sort of joint venture. And I think I'm interested in hearing more from Moreno because I do think there's a lot that the United States and Europe can do, if not together, then sort of action in concert. I note that the United States has been long in stages of negotiation with China on a bilateral investment treaty. Europe is also negotiating a bilateral investment treaty with China. I was pleased to learn about 6 months ago that our negotiators are talking with the European negotiators. Right? That's great, okay? Because you can do a lot with a bilateral investment treaty, not just protection of investors. You read in things like transparency, it's the sort of the Administrative Procedures Act with Asian characteristics. Those kinds of things would really help when it comes to governance and economic management and decision making. There's probably a longer list we could create, but it's a very important one. In terms of what happens next, look, TPP in 2016, we can get into it in the Q&A, but my sense is everybody in Washington is trying to write a script about what's happening in 2016, and a lot of those scripts have already been torn up several times, whether it's in the presidential race or in Congress or on the trade front. But I did want to point out, great achievement on TPP. Real concern that you can read in the numbers on what's going on in the region. And a real need for important Asian partners of Asia, like the United States and Europe, to find ways to work together to move ahead. Thank you.
Thanks, Scott. Moreno?
Thanks. And I start from considerations similar to what Scott have just developed. I mean, what we have seen since the Great Recession has been that the trade and investment dynamics have been disappointing particularly weak. And in fact, I mean, trade that used to have an elasticity of about 2 compared to growth is now below 1. It means that trade is growing less than GDP growth. And this has been one of the missing engine for the global recovery. And not to speak to investment, it has been even worse, and that explains a lot of things, including the slowdown in productivity growth around the world. So I think that the issue is that we need to make trade and investment engines of growth again, and this is also one of the priorities of the Chinese presidency of the G20. And in fact, they have created, especially a working group on the non-trade and investment. So the I mean, the best way, and we know that what the first best is that would have been a multilateral trade agreement would have been the preferred one, but that's not been possible. I mean, it's not been possible even when there was a very strong pressure. I mean, if you go to see the declaration of the G20 summit in 2009-2010, all the leaders of the G20 agreed that it was time to conclude. They put it in writing, but in the end, it was not possible. So the second best have been free trade agreements or even super FTAs, as the TPP is. And not surprisingly, Asia has been targeted both by the United States and Europe because it's been the most dynamic region in the world, and trade would be and could be a win-win situation for everybody, even in the context of shrinking and less dynamism in trade and investment. So the in that respect, if the TPP is ratified, and we hope so, we have no problem with it. As Commissioner Malmström said, success breeds success. So we hope that this will breed success also for our negotiation, and I'll come in a minute to that in Asia, as well as maybe success breeds success also in our TTIP negotiation between the United States and the European Union. So what we are doing on the European side? So we have free trade agreements with Korea, as Gunnar Wiegand was showing, that it is working pretty well. I mean, one of the interesting things was that at a certain moment the Koreans had problems, say that we have just concluded free trade agreement with Europe, and Europe is a recession. So Europeans are going to benefit more than us. But if you look at the trade data, what you find is true that, I mean, during the sovereign debt crisis, Korean export to Europe have stagnated. But where there was the FTA, Korean export have, in fact, increased both in volume and value. So, I mean, that was, in the end, a win-win situation. Had not been the Korean export would have declined in absolute terms. We have concluded negotiations with Singapore and Vietnam, and we have now to implement them. And we are negotiating a super FTA, if you want, with Japan. It has been a little bit delayed also because many of the Japanese negotiators were engaged in the TPP. So we hope that now they will turn. I mean, this could be very important because we have very strong economic ties with Japan, and it would imply all of a set of norms, non-tariff barriers, public procurement that could have a positive effect both for the EU and Japan. And we are also negotiating with Malaysia, we launched with Philippines, we have with Thailand and India. We have also with China, that is the elephant in the room, also negotiating as well as the United States an investment agreement. It's important that we talk to each other, not to gang up the one with the other, but to be informed on how things are proceeding and to see where progress can be made and to work together, because I mean this investment agreement can be particularly important in the context of a closer integration of China in the global economy. And discussing on TPP and beyond, so beyond going also in areas where they are, I mean, less typical and less in the comfort zone of trade negotiators, we have, with regard to China, the One Belt, One Road initiative that, in a way, is trying to rebalance looking Pacific policy that China's developed in the last two or three decades, also trying to develop a channel of investment and prosperity that goes from Asia to Europe through to Central Asia, and we look with interest at the thing, but also with some cautious because we have to see how that will be implemented. And on the Chinese side, there's been quite a lot of interest for the Juncker investment plan, so to be able to participate in our initiative to relaunch investment in infrastructure, but not only in infrastructure in Europe, and way of for them to put into productive use part of the reserve, the huge amount of reserve that they have, even if they declined recently, but they're still quite a number there. I'm going to conclude just a mention, because it was in the request of the thing, I mean, where the U.S. And Europe can cooperate further in economic terms in China. I think that one thing is that before going to cooperation, I think that it is important to have an healthy, fair competition to increase our respective shares in Asian markets. And therefore, I mean, we are competitors, as Gunnar was mentioning, and not only cooperators. But, I mean, the important thing is that I think that we have a common interest in having a number of barriers removed and to have a level playing field where the various companies and firms can compete, and in which some domestic, often state-owned enterprises have an unfair share of the market, that in a more open trade environment would be different, and I mean, and there would be much more European and U.S. presence. I think that we have learned from, and this come back to my experience when I was in Japan, from our previous experience of negotiating bilaterally with Asian countries, where sometimes we targeted specific sectors that were considered important strategic either for the US and the European Union. I think that a much more horizontal pressure is quite useful in that respect. I mean, the TPP and the FTAs can help a lot, because I mean, we look for instance in Japan. What Abe is saying, Prime Minister Abe is saying, is that through the free trade agreements, we can carry out the reforms that we need to revitalize our economy. And on that, I think that we are moving in the same direction, and that is particularly positive. And so I think that in these areas, and in the areas also of investment and, let's say, also less traditional type of economic relations between the US, Europe, and China, and the Asia in general. I was thinking, for instance, at the recent agreement on climate change and so on, there are areas where we can speak together and try to have things moving forward in a situation that in the end is together with our Asian partner a win-win situation for everybody.
Thank you, all three of you. Thank you very much. Marino, maybe I could start with you. What is the EU doing with ASEAN per se? And I know you're negotiating obviously with its independent components, but the EU-ASEAN engagement. And does Europe see, like the United States apparently does, according to President Obama in his remarks at Sunnylands over the last couple of days, that ASEAN could be a center point for emerging regional economic architecture?
We have been very supportive of ASEAN all along the creation. I mean, we have had a number of discussions with them. We have seen them also a pivotal element in the Chiang Mai initiative to create a regional financial arrangements in the area. In that respect, as also Gunnar say, I mean, we have a strong relation with ASEAN. We favor regional arrangements that are rule-based and they try to advance the regional integration and be a strong partner with us. I mean, what has not been possible because we had started was to have a free trade arrangement with Asia as itself, because we realized after a number of rounds that, I mean, the it was very difficult for the ASEAN at the moment to have to be able to reach a trade agreement that was much more than a minimum common denominator, and therefore certain moment we decided to go for bilateral agreements. As I said, we have already signed with Singapore and Vietnam. We have ongoing with Malaysia and Thailand and Philippines. We start soon. Having said that, we are pretty positive on the development of ASEAN, and we discuss with them in a continuous manner the issue of how to develop integration and closer relation with them.
So let me turn to, thank you very much. Let me turn to Drew and ask, you know, how did the president handle the TPP or the economic discussion with the ASEAN leaders at Sunnylands? Because you have four members of ASEAN and the TPP, and a couple others are interested. Others, you know, it'd be hard to imagine anytime soon, right? But how do you think about, how do the Americans think about strengthening ASEAN while trying to move ahead on trade?
Well, you know, I think those are things that can be pursued in tandem. I think we've been clear from the start of TPP. One of the benefits of TPP was that it was a regional framework, a regional platform, so no one was being excluded. It was simply that some countries, including some within ASEAN, were ready to step forward, ready to either prepared because they already, you know, had that kind of regime in place, or they were prepared to make those reforms, which was the case in Vietnam, you know, now, whereas other countries weren't there yet. But I think, you know, we've always said that, you know, our goal, you know, ideally would be to see all of the ASEAN countries be in a position to you know, seek membership. And I think then, you know, what we're trying to do, though, is not simply say, well, you know, so get back to us when you're ready, but actually find ways to engage in a less ambitious way, frankly, that will enable countries that either don't have the capacity or are still developing the political will within ASEAN to start to engage with us. I mean, a lot of these are sort of behind the border regulatory issues, and part of the issue is simply actually getting to establish a dialogue where people can understand why, you know, what we're seeking to do actually will bring benefits for their own sort of domestic regime with respect to growth, with respect to transparency. We wouldn't have gotten countries to sign up to these obligations if this was harmful to them. And I think, you know, actually that was one of the things that helped us in the TPP negotiations as it dragged on, was that we actually were able to develop those kind of relationships among the various negotiating partners over the years. And I think, you know, that's the kind of dialogue that the president and Ambassador Froman want to get started with the other ASEAN members.
Thank you very much. So, Scott. Could we turn to you, and I'd welcome comments from the others. Can we pass TPP through Congress this year in the lame duck session or otherwise? And what's the outlook then for TTIP, and how do you think about linking the two, if you think about that at all?
Okay. Sure. Well, look, the politics are kind of bad and getting worse, I guess, as it would be in a nutshell. This is a short year. Recall the Trade Priorities Act of 2015 indicated that if a implementing legislation were submitted by the administration, that Congress would need to act on it within 90 legislative days. By my count, there are fewer than 90 legislative days remaining in calendar 2016. Just for reference, Congress adjourns. They're not here this week. They'll be back off and on. They adjourn for the conventions early, July 15th, and then adjourn about the beginning of October to go home and campaign for their own elections. So there's not a lot of time available. Second, the leaders of Congress appear, at least from their public statements, unconvinced that this is a top priority that they ought to proceed with. Senator McConnell's been pretty clear. I mean, think of it from his point of view. Senator McConnell likes being the majority leader. he'd like to stay the majority leader. I love working at CSIS. I want to stay working for CSIS. So that's not an uncommon urge. Okay. So Senator McConnell is actually concerned principally with a few close Senate races, with the fate of Senator, say, Ayotte or Johnson or Portman or Toomey. That's probably a higher priority for him than passing the president's trade agreement, as he would see it. So that's a fact at the moment, as he has expressed it publicly. Likewise, this weekend, on the 14th specifically, Speaker Ryan appeared on Fox News and basically said the votes aren't there for TPP and the administration needs to fix the agreement. At least that's what I heard him say. Pretty clear statement, not definitive, but that's kind of where the congressional leadership is. Meanwhile, the rumble in both presidential campaigns is the agreement's not good enough. That's essentially what former Secretary Clinton has said about the TPP when asked. And I think that's what Donald Trump is saying, but I can't really say for sure. I know that everybody else is lousy at negotiating, and he'd bring back something that was luxurious. But beyond that, that's the sort of meme is not good enough. Now, what happens is anybody's guess. Stepwise, it's pretty straightforward. I think both the House Ways and Means Committee and the Senate Finance Committee hold hearings this spring. There may be a sweet spot for action in the spring because we milk all the politics out of the presidential race and things quiet down and a lot of members are past their primaries. I don't know. I doubt it, but it's possible. But certainly after the hearings, both houses count the votes and see how short they are, and then there's a decision to be made. How much of a priority is this? How much political capital needs to be expended? Not impossible. I would note Bill Clinton in his last year in office, the year 2000, also a presidential election year, got the Congress to pass permanent normal trade relations with China, did it with an overwhelming vote. I think 71 House Democrats voted for that bill. Frankly, if there were 71 House Democrats who were willing to vote for TPP, we could pass TPP too. So it's one of those things. It took a lot of work to get there. President Clinton put a huge amount of political capital into it. He had one of the finest legislative affairs operations led by Chuck Brain in the Clinton White House there at the end of his administration. They were really skillful people who did very hard work to get it across, and so it can be done. But that's the kind of decision making you'll see. So whether or not it happens, I don't know. Certainly, I think TPP deserves the pass. Ultimately, will one way or another. This year is, of course, the giant question mark. So in terms of what happens next and how TTIP or other initiatives might intrude on this. Look, TTIP is on its own timetable, probably based on statements from the administration. The press secretary most recently extends beyond this administration. That's okay. This is the big economic relationship. A lot of subtleties. A lot of finesse. Required for this, but still an important agreement, one that deserves attention and deserves completion. In the meantime, for me, the real agenda, particularly the agenda for Asia, ought to be what the U.S. and Europe can do in concert in other fora, and I think we ought to get creative. Look, the information technology agreement, after 19 years, was just updated in the WTO. It's a plurilateral agreement in the WTO. Only about a third of the WTO members, but 90% of trade in those products subscribe to the agreement. The last holdout was, big surprise, China. Probably wind up being, I know this is a prediction, they'll be the biggest beneficiary of this agreement over the next 19 years, but they were the hardest to get to yes. US and Europe worked very diligently as partners to make that happen. We could do that again. For instance, TPP has a wonderful chapter on the digital economy, very beneficial chapter on the digital economy. All right, it's a chapter that's agreeable to the United States and to Vietnam, okay? Why not set that up in a discussion in Geneva and make it a plurilateral agreement subscribed by as many WTO members as care to do it? You start with 15, the TPP parties, and a few others who have similar obligations made. So it's an interesting notion. It's one that could advance an area of expanding international commerce where the rules are scarce. In fact, the digital economy didn't exist when GATT 94 was created. All right, so let's look for creative ways to go forward. So that's just one idea, but I do think there's a lot as US and Europe continue the negotiations on TTIP, which has its own rhythm and own dynamic. There are some things we can do in the global context, not needing to resurrect Doha, not needing to do anything, but we can do it because it's the right thing to do, do it on a sectoral basis, do it where it makes sense, and get some forward momentum in trade negotiations.
Drew or Marina, do you guys want to comment on
which element?
Any opinion expressed? Yeah.
I mean, I guess I'd just, you know, say with respect to TPP process, without you know, getting involved in politics, you know, I'd say as a veteran of the chorus process, you know, the debate on that was a you know, not particularly positive one. And at the end of the day, that agreement was passed, as all of our past trade agreements have been as well. Less than a year ago, while we were actually out in Guam in the middle of a typhoon negotiating TPP, this town was consumed with a TPA debate, and everyone declared that it would never pass and that trade policy was dead. And that was certainly, you know, the lead article in the paper for a few days. And then ultimately it did pass, and that was, you know, buried in the far reaches of Section D. And, you know, we actually got the authority from Congress to proceed with these negotiations. So, you know, I think, you know, we look forward to having a good, robust debate about this, but I just think it's important to note that the rhetoric about these trade debates usually tends to be focused on the impossibility and the many reasons why this will never get approved. And then ultimately, actually, we do have trade policy, and we are able to get to the critical mass necessary to get these things approved. I also would say that, you know, as someone who's involved in this, I think we can see that, you know, members of the historic trade coalition have now, I think, done a more thorough review of the agreement and are actually speaking out more forthrightly about the value of the agreement as well as the cost to the United States of not moving forward with it. I think we also see that some of the other TPP partners are beginning to begin their own domestic approval processes, Malaysia, as well as Australia and New Zealand beginning their process, and other countries talking about beginning it soon. So I think that will also sort of make it clear that this is not simply, you know, this is something where the U.S. also has sort of a regional responsibility to the partners that we've engaged in this for 5 years. I mean, we should be, you know, they I think look to us to play our part in this process as well. So, and I also think, you know, when we talk about the impact on TTIP, I mean, yeah, these are discrete negotiations; they're different. But I also think, frankly, a lot of our partners will look at us and say, you know, the United States is able to negotiate these great agreements, but can you actually get them approved? And I think that's something that, you know, we have to speak candidly about that. That's what people are going to look at when this is an agreement that has, you know, drawn, you know, fairly positive evaluations in terms of what it does in terms of, you know, deepening trade and investment ties in the region. And if you know, our process needs to now actually see that through to fruition. I also would just to follow up on Scott's final point. I think, you know, not as a substitute for TPP certainly, but I think, you know, taking elements of TPP that we worked on, particularly those that represent new approaches to electronic commerce, to state-owned enterprises, you know, even some of the like existing disciplines on things like technical barriers to trade, TBT, SPS. One of our goals here was not just to address this in the Asia Pacific, but actually to try to identify ways forward to address this in a plurilateral or multilateral way. And I think that's actually one of the things, one of the intended objectives here. And I think we'd really welcome sort of working with the European Union where we have common ground to try to move those forward more broadly.
I think that we're already cooperating a lot, and we have open channel of communications, including on Asia, and we are doing a lot. And definitely more could be done. Even in areas where we had differences, for instance, the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, despite that many European countries decided to enter as founding members, and the U.S. decided to stay away. I mean, there was always a discussion inside the G7 on the criteria in order to make sure that the AIB would respect certain best practices internationally. I think that we have achieved that. The transposition of the TPP more in general, I can understand that, I mean, being this type of agreements, super FTAs that have also broader aspects, that is fine. I always a little bit unconvinced on the fact that you can transpose something mechanically and generalize it. So I think that we will have to look in the in detail to the various issues. The European Commission will soon come out with its proposal on the digital agenda. We will have to see how much compatible the things are. I think that we will have interesting discussion ahead. So the but nevertheless, this doesn't take away the thing that, I mean, we can discuss and cooperate on the basis of what is on the table and on the basis of what we are doing in other negotiations as European Union, as we have, as I said, with Japan and also in our bilateral negotiations.
Let's open the floor up to some questions. These two gentlemen look like they are poised, so right up here. You guys can decide which one goes first.
U.S. first.
Okay, that's very kind of you. Okay. Could you just identify yourself?
Sure. And then... thanks. Matt Schuhl from Inside U.S. Trade. Had some questions for Mr. Quinn about looking path forward for TPP. Two questions. The first one is, you know, I mean, you talked about the ratification TPP and, you know, the chances in Congress, Scott Miller talked about. But in terms of actually implementing the agreement, it seems like another challenge that you guys are working on. And I understand the administration is developing this administration-wide implementation plan that's required under TPA. And so I was just wondering, you know, since the Obama administration will leave office at the end of, you know, in about a year, less than a year, how exactly can you ensure through that plan that, you know, or, you know, include any types of promises that TPP will be implemented in a certain way? I mean, will you try to set up structures that will keep that going? Because people are sure to say, well, how can you make promises about how you implemented it if you're going to be leaving? And secondly, have you received any specific proposals from Senator Hatch on how he wants to improve TPP? This was something that USTR was waiting for, sort of the ball, said the ball was in his court. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. With respect to implementation, I mean, I think we have a number of requirements under the Trade Promotion Authority. With respect to the Trade Promotion Authority legislation, I think, you know, we're still working on how to prepare to meet them. Obviously, the agreement was just signed a couple of weeks ago. We have not yet received the International Trade Commission assessment of the projected benefits. So there's still some steps to go. But I think, you know, one of the things that we're very much focused on is for an agreement this significant, ensuring that indeed it will be fully implemented and that the anticipated and projected benefits will be realized and that the obligations will be adhered to. So yeah, it's an area that we're focusing on. You know, with respect to how one would guarantee it, I think, you know, ultimately, if this is an agreement that is approved by Congress, ultimately we assume there will be the necessary support for its implementation, you know, whatever year. With respect to Senator Hatch, I have not been in touch with him. You know, I think we are continuing to consult very closely with all members of Congress about their interest in the agreement and particular concerns. And you know, we'll continue that process going forward.
Yes, thank you. Jean-François Boitin, two questions. The first one, more minute, important case. How important is it for EU and the US to come to a common position on non-market economy status on China? It was, I think, part of the success of the negotiations for the WTO accession of China was that there were was an intense dialogue between negotiators and both teams. So I think that's a crucial point, really, in the short term. Longer term, there is a big difference between the EU. We heard Gunnar said, we don't do geopolitics. And obviously, Brussels does not have any aircraft carrier, regrettably. Geopolitics are very important, a very important argument. In making the case for TPP. So how this difference will have an impact on our common relationship with Asian countries?
Scott and Marianne, you should start.
I imagine there will be consultations on China's non-market economy status. I imagine there'll be close consultations between the governments of the United States and Europe. Ultimately, not to be too cynical, but I think what will probably happen in the United States is we'll have some good proposals for meeting our WTO obligations, and then Congress will not act, and we'll wind up losing a WTO case and a few years down the road. And at some point, we will, in some omnibus bill, we'll fix the error, much as we did recently with country of origin labeling for meat products, which was known a known violation of our obligations or contrary to our obligations the day we did it, and it took the loss of a dispute panel and an omnibus bill to fix it. So that is probably not to be too cynical of the likely path, but I'm certain that there will be a careful study of each other's proposals in the U.S. and Europe before that calamity occurs.
Yeah,
okay. I'm sorry to be.
I mean, the Gunnar before described exactly what's going on, so we cannot prejudge the outcome. We are looking at all the various factors at the, and after a decision will be taken. There is communication clearly with the U.S. administration. We will see what the outcome is. At this stage, it's difficult to prejudge, and I mean, I will not be able to give an answer on. As Gunnar say, I mean, this is something that is open. Coming back to the geopolitics, we are not doing geopolitics, but of course, we are looking at the politics and so on. I mean, one of the things that we see that is important is for the European Union to engage Asia in general, in particular China, in the global governance and in the global community. So, I mean, for that reason, we have a particularly strong relationship, and we are acting in order to try to have China more and more involved in adopting and behaving in a way that is compatible to the rule of the international community. And that, I think that this has happened on a number of fields. As I was saying, I mean, take the creation of the AIB. I mean, initially it was clearly a China alone initiative that they tried to involve before a number of countries in the area as well as the Gulf country. And after advanced economies, I mean the. But on the other end, they were aware that I mean, if they had gone alone, and they could have gone alone, or without the advanced countries, or even not trying to involve them, then there would have been a backlash, and would have been considered something sort of unilateral initiative and not. Something that was really truly regional. Maybe they could have been a little bit more generous. I mean, they could have, for instance, found the headquarters not necessarily in Beijing, but in another Asian country would have probably worked better and also dispelled some concerns. But, I mean, the way in which we have engaged, either in or outside, has provided in the end an outcome that we consider not negative. And you could take a lot of other examples that goes from environmental standards, trying to improve the situation in terms of environment, or trying to tackle some of the key problems that they have. I mean, they're still not doing enough, but I mean, both our pressure and the pressure on the United States to tackle the issue of overcapacity, we start to see that we have a number of outcomes. So in all this, I think that, I mean, the as Gunnar presented it, I mean, it's not we are not doing geopolitics, but we are doing politics and dealing with these countries as partners, and try to have them more and more engaged in the international context. and China that started with a very far away position. We have seen a lot of developments. Not always all developments are positive, and we know that, but the general trend has been rather on the positive side, in particular on the economy, but much more is still needed.
Well, please join me in thanking our three panelists for an excellent discussion. Thank you very much.